Good evening. The generosity shown to the people of the Southwest Coast has been so enormous, so much so. In Portobas, donations have expanded into six buildings, and trucks full of items continue to arrive from across the province. NTV's Don Bradshaw joins me live from Portobas with more on all of that this evening. Don.
Thank you very much, Tony. As you mentioned, since post-tropical storm Fiona blew through here on Saturday, almost immediately when people here woke up on Sunday morning, the response began, and not just in this region, across the province, really across the country. I've heard stories of people donating gift cards from as far away as British Columbia. I'm joined right now by Holly Wells, Vicky McDougall, and Vicky's daughter, Noelle. These ladies are involved in the response. They're processing. They're taking all the donations that are coming in across the province. And Holly, I want to ask you about what we've seen happen here over the last 4 or 5 days. The response in terms of donations from across the province and throughout the country has been phenomenal.
It really has. It's been quite overwhelming, actually, trying to deal with everything that's coming in. And we just can't be more grateful for everyone that's been supporting us.
Tell me about that response. I mentioned, you know, these are coming from across the province, and that is exactly what you're getting. Tell me where all the response coming from?
We've had trucks from Stephenville, Corner Brook, Pasadena, Grand Falls, Twilling Gate, and as far as St. John's, who have picked up right across the province.
And even though we are now 4 or 5 days into this response, this is not easing off. We were at your the Lions Club earlier today, and I noticed there were two tractor trailers being unloaded even then.
Yes, there was. It's been nonstop. Every day there's new trucks coming in the evenings. We're always looking for volunteers to try to offload all of these items. This evening it was a lot of water, which was great, which is badly needed by everybody in the community.
So one thing about this response, and at the risk of sounding ungrateful, you're now at a point where the donations, you've received enough material objects, you know, clothing and shoes and things like that. Vicky, I want to ask you about what it is now that you're looking for. I take it there are still some, I'll call them objects that you'd like to receive that people may need around here for the foreseeable future.
Yeah, and it's more depends on the family and their situation. Now we're really looking for financial donations, gift cards, so people can go and pick up what they need, because the donations are fabulous, but there's so much, and it's not exactly what each family needs depending on their situation.
And as we look around here, obviously there are some homes destroyed, but there will be people who will be fortunate enough to be able to move back in their homes. We were talking earlier about what they're going to need to get back in their homes, even things as simple as cleaning products. Is that something that you're in demand for now?
There was one family came in looking for a dehumidifier today, and mops and buckets and things to clean the houses, either that they're back allowed into and cleaning up messes, or into new houses to get it ready for their families.
So we'll go back to the financial aspect, because obviously money is what people can use, because they can choose their own items and what they need. How do people across the province, around the country, around the world for that matter, how can they donate to this cause?
So there's two different ways. They can donate to the Red Cross, and then the government matches donations, or they can donate to the credit union, and it's they can e-transfer at Fiona Disaster Relief at ace or dot ac
AECU.ca.
Sorry, I probably have that messed up. But
we can look it up online. It's easy enough to find. You were practicing that. But people will definitely be able to find that. Tony, one of the things I wanted to mention, we talk about all the products, all the materials, all the items that are being donated here. And it's really, you would not believe the amount of items that are here. As you mentioned, this started out as a one-building response. And throughout the course of the last 5 days, we're now at six buildings. The response has been so tremendous that there's been an overflow set up to handle all these products, and now it's six buildings in this community that are storing these items that have been donated. And you talk about the things that have been donated around the province or from across the province. One of the things we saw coming in here this afternoon that kind of caught my interest was there's this tanker truck parked downtown. And for the last couple of days, I've been watching it and saying, what is that tanker truck? It turns out A company in Cornerbrook donated 36,000 liters of water in this tanker truck because this we're still under a boil order here in this community. A lot of people need clean water for a number of different things. So there's a company in Cornerbrook who donated 36,000 liters of water that people can go down with canisters and whatever they can carry water in and fill up and take it from there. Again, something you wouldn't necessarily expect to see as a donation, but it just shows the generosity of people from throughout the province that have been responding to this cause. We'll be back a little bit later on to tell you a little bit more about what's happening here in Portobas. But for now, Tony, it's back to you.
All right. Thank you so much, Don. NTV's Don Bradshaw reporting live tonight from Portobas. Welcome back to First Edition. Imagine losing everything you own in an instant. Your home and all of your belongings gone in the blink of an eye. The emotional trauma can seem overwhelming and you wonder if you're ever going to get over it. Well, joining me now is Dr. Janine Hubbard with this week's Get Psyched with Dr. Janine. It's great to see you.
Thank you. And thank you to you and all of the team for all the coverage and keeping all of us up to date over the last week. I know it's been an extremely draining, exhausting week and a lot for everyone in the province to process, let alone, again, my thoughts going out to the people who've been directly involved.
You know, Dr. Janine, we've all seen those videos. We've heard the heart-wrenching stories from the Southwest Coast. What do you make of what they're going through right now?
It's unimaginable. And what I will say is for most people, they at the moment are just in survival mode of coping. Some are finding some lovely rays of light, like, you know, the few remaining items that are there. But for most people at this point, it's the practical, functional, getting their needs met. Here you go. I'm going to give you an intro psych. We have Maslow's hierarchy of needs. You can't worry about your psychological functioning until you have things like a bed and a roof and food and clothing. And that's where most people are at the moment. So we're anticipating that the psychological reactions, while certainly people are feeling very emotional right now, the more advanced processing is going to happen a little bit further down the road for most people.
So what are the stages of this reaction? And is this kind of like grieving?
This is grieving. This is trauma. This is a whole lot of things all rolled into one. At the moment, most people are in the acute coping phase. And that's where your adrenal system's on overdrive and it's mobilizing you to do all the things that you need to do and be very action-oriented. The problem is you can't keep up that pace forever. And at a certain point, it's like moving from the sprint to the marathon. We all did that collectively with COVID. And I think people will remember some people made that transition easier than others. Because functionally, we have to move to the marathon phase at some point where it is the, okay, I need to sit and process this. I need to kind of look forward and figure out big, big picture next steps. And that's going to be really challenging for a lot of people.
So you say next steps and look at the big picture and the long term. So what is the long term effect of going through something like this?
It's going to vary from individual to individual. We know that there's a small percentage of people who are going to look at this and go, right, you know what? This is awful and I'm moving on. The vast majority of people will probably get there, you know, but need a little bit longer. And then there's always a percentage of people for whom we really worry about them getting stuck and not being able to move forward. And that's, the group that we're always, we want to support everyone, obviously, but that's the group that we worry about. Sometimes it's pre-existing mental health issues. Sometimes it's what we almost call complicated bereavement, where there may be some really complicated relationship tied up with that house or with some of the lost belongings, let alone, loss of life. There are a lot of reasons why for some people it's a much more complex process.
Dr. Janine, we are nearly out of time, but if people are looking for help or recognize tonight that they need help, where can they find it?
Again, when in doubt, call 811. I know there have been some supports put in place and we're looking at things in place. Reach out to friends and family. Talk about it. Reach out to a family physician if you have one. And don't be shy about saying, I think I need help. Because if ever there was a situation in this province where everyone is ready to step up and help out our citizens, this is it.
Dr. Janine Hubbard, thank you so much for coming in.
Thanks, Tony.
First Edition, Speaker's Corner.
Welcome back to First Edition. As the people of Puerto Basque and surrounding areas continue to deal with the devastation of last week's hurricane, tonight in Speaker's Corner, we asked if you have a message for those impacted.
Oh, that's the usual, that we feel for them and, stay strong, and I'm sure everything is going to work out. And lots of help from everybody. That's what I would say.
Well, I don't know what. All I can say is that I wish them well. It's devastating to watch, and trust that they'll get the coverage that they need from government, both levels, federal and provincial, and I wish them well.
How does it feel to know that that's where you come from, to see what's happening over there?
Well, it's never good when you realize that it's people just like us, everyday people, who are got to start their lives all over again, and some of those people are not very young to start over again, so I wish them well.
It's unfortunate. Hopefully everybody gets things cleaned up soon and looked after, and get everything rebuilt again, I guess.
I wish them very well. A lot of people from that area works on the boats, the ships on the Great Lakes. I work with them, cooks, engineers in nautical science, and I got a lot of friends over there, and I wish them well. And if there's anything I can do, I'm an heavy equipment operator, to like to go over and help them for free as a volunteer.
God bless and stay strong, and hang in there.
So it was in a hard time last week due to the hurricanes, and these days it's also affecting the coast of America. So my message to everybody is stay safe with your family. Don't go outside until everything is fine, and best wishes to all.
Good evening. The cleanup continues along the southwest coast from the damage caused by Fiona.
Tonight we hear stories, more stories, of the close calls some residents had at the height of that storm. NTV's Don Bradshaw has been in Puerto Basque all week. He joins us live with more. Don?
Thank you, Tony. As you say, we have been telling the stories of the people of Puerto Basque and the southwest coast all this week, the losses that they've experienced. This home behind me once belonged to a gentleman a week ago. This was his home. He obviously lost everything in this, but for him, it could have been much worse. Around Puerto Basque, he's known as Smokey. But after his harrowing ordeal in the peak of last week's post-tropical storm, Brian Osmond may soon have a new nickname, Lucky. Smokey was in his home on Saturday morning when post-tropical storm Fiona struck. At one point, he went outside to his vehicle, but when he closed the door on his truck, his life forever changed.
I moved my truck and went out, not door go in. That way he took me. And I was underwater netting. Well, he said I got my hands all beat up. And no, it's not too bad now, but it was. My knees and all that. But I went under the water and I just tried to get up. And when I got up, my brother grabbed me and hauled me in.
With waves as high as 40 feet and winds gusting to over 140 kilometers an hour, Smokey knows how close he came to losing his life. But as he was being tossed around by the sea, he only had one thought.
No, I was just trying to stay alive. Like, everybody say, what was going through your mind? Going through your mind was stay alive. That's all.
Smokey's home was located near the shoreline in one of the hardest hit areas of town. After he was pulled from the sea to safety, he went to his brother's home to get some dry clothes. When he returned to his own home, the building was destroyed, left in tatters by the pounding surf that nearly cost him his life. On Wednesday, during a tour of the impact zone, Prime Minister Justin Trudeau spoke briefly with Smokey outside what's left of his home.
Now, he said they're going to help us and all that, and I hope they do. I mean, they're giving money to everybody else, so. Like I said, I'm soon be 62 years old, out of home and everything. I don't want to start over, but I'm going to have to. I don't want to get no loans. I'm only on a small pension, so.
Do you believe him when he says he'll help?
I do, honest. I hope to. Do. If you don't, I won't be voting for them no more.
And Mr. Osmond, or Smokey, obviously has a long way to go to rebuild. Like many people in this neighborhood, this process is going to take quite a while. And it's a matter of him and others here now trying to find a way to move on with their lives. Mike, back to you.
Thank you very much, Don. NTV's Don Bradshaw live in Port-au-Basque. In the wake of Hurricane Fiona, the province's infrastructure minister says we need to start preparing for more adverse weather events caused by climate change.
Just from a roads perspective, in terms of planning, I've been minister responsible for infrastructure for a year and a half now, and the climate change lens is always applied to the planning process. Whether we replace a culvert, it's a larger culvert depending on the highway, the project that it involves, but that climate change lens is certainly applied to all of our conversations and all of our plannings, because as we see, it's a reality. And as I said, we've installed many culverts through our roadways in the province in the last year and a half, and they've been larger culverts in size because we recognize the climate change and the potential, and trying to be proactive. And we've had many conversations. I've had conversations with federal counterparts as well in terms of coastal erosion and proactively planning that this doesn't happen. But as we can see, we've seen from Fiona, it was fierce and something that we're trying to prepare for. But it's a difficult task. But we're planning in that route.
Volunteers who organize food drives in this province say the high cost of groceries is making things difficult as they try and take care of those who are hungry. NTV's Colleen Lewis with more.
Volunteers with the Grand Falls Windsor Community Kitchen prepare meals every week for hungry people in the community. And they also partner with the Salvation Army to ensure there's plenty of food on hand. Today, they are preparing for a major food drive this coming weekend.
Yeah, this food will be given to the Salvation Army Food Bank, and they will look after distributions to people here in Central Newfoundland.
But they say the high cost of groceries is making their job growingly difficult.
Oh, it's getting real hard, Colleen. Right now, with the price of food and the availability, Community Kitchen depends on basically donations and volunteers, and donations now are getting harder and harder to get with the price of product. And we have more and more people coming in every day that are in need of food, right? We even get calls, people looking for food for their families. They don't have enough to feed their kids, etc. So we help out wherever we can.
And with the holiday season quickly approaching, the donations may not see the levels they have in previous years.
All right, with the price of meat products, turkeys, etc., price of vegetables are gone to the roof, and we usually put off Christmas dinner, and it's going to be very costly for us right now.
The food drive will take place here at Sobeys this coming Saturday until 3 p.m. For NTV News, I'm Colleen Lewis in Grand Falls, Windsor.
Canadian Blood Services has seen a number of appointment cancellations across Atlantic Canada in the wake of Fiona. Now they're asking Newfoundlanders and Labradorians to fill those empty seats. NTV's Mary-Kate O'Neill has more.
Post-tropical storm Fiona caused catastrophic damage across Atlantic Canada. Forcing multiple blood donor clinics to shut down for a period of time, leaving many appointments unfilled.
On this past Saturday, September the 24th, all of our donor centres in Nova Scotia, New Brunswick and PEI were closed due to the hurricane.
And that's where Newfoundland and Labrador comes in. Canadian Blood Services is a national blood bank, and if people here donate blood, it can be sent to provinces that are now low on supply because of cancellations and clinic closures.
We need residents and communities that was less impacted by Hurricane Fiona to step up and come out and donate blood.
But that's only if the clinic here in St. John's is operating at a full supply capacity. And unfortunately, it's not.
When we have incidents like happened last weekend with Hurricane Fiona, you know, we're able to help out our neighbors as well if we have a little bit of a surplus, and vice versa, if our supplies are a little bit low, we are able to bring in.
With October just around the corner, there is a vast number of vacant appointments that need to be filled in the next month.
It's only a couple of days away from October, and we have over 600 unfilled appointment slots here in the St. John's area. And we need all blood types every single day of the year to ensure that we have adequate supplies for hospital patients. Our goal is to collect what's needed here in the province. If somebody is interested in donating, they can go to blood.ca or download the Give Blood app, book their life-saving appointment.
Mary Kate O'Neill, NTV News.
Welcome back to the NTV Evening News Hour. Many families on the Southwest Coast lost everything after Fiona. Now, those who saw the devastation from afar are doing what they can to help. NTV's Mary Kate O'Neill has this inspiring story.
It was heartbreaking to hear and devastating to see. Fiona battered part of the province, demolishing homes, uprooting families, taking no mercy in her cruel path. But it didn't take long for help to arrive. The province rallied together to do what it does best. Help others.
So here today we're collecting, for the last 2 days we've been collecting donations for the people of Port of Basque and the South Coast, I guess. The guard's been pretty busy taking stuff in, sorting through it, and trying to get a trailer ready to go to Port of Basque on Friday.
And they aren't the only ones. Best Movers also has a truck full of supplies and are headed for Port of Basque. One Memorial University student got to work as soon as she heard the Southwest Coast was in dire straits, rounding up donations to supply many communities with period products.
So I sent out on social media that I was hoping to collect donations of menstrual products and have them shipped to the communities affected by Fiona. And the response was massive. Within 3 days, over 2,000 menstrual products have been distributed to Port au Basque, Burnt Islands, Stephenville, and the Eskasoni in Nova Scotia.
It's beautiful to see people uniting in a time of tragedy. That's what Brad Sims had to say after his father sent him this video, which he later posted to Facebook. From Burgio, now living in Halifax, he said it was hard to watch his hometown struggle. But what got him through was the resilience of these residents and their immediate need to help one another. Nothing explains Newfoundland and Labrador quite like these stories. Kindness, perseverance, it's who we are.
Well, I mean, for us, of course, well, we're Newfoundlanders and we're going to help people.
When I saw the pictures, it was pretty heartbreaking. And, you know, period products are not on the top of our disaster relief list, so I thought it would be really nice to have these sent over.
These are just some of the many inspiring stories that came out of Fiona's devastation. And as a region rebuilds, there will be many more to come. For Inspiring NL, I'm Mary Kate O'Neill.
One woman was killed and about 100 homes in the area were destroyed or severely damaged by the powerful storm surge. As Ross Lord explains, among the biggest challenges now is what to do next.
Port of Basque Harbor has returned to its enchanting appearance, dominated by rugged natural breakwaters. And there's incremental progress in the cleanup and in the day-to-day life of residents who still have homes.
Taking the residents and the electrician in to have a quick assessment of their electrical situation and their panels and see if it looks safe enough to let those residents go back in.
But the brutal remnants of Fiona's overwhelming storm surge are still everywhere as people who live on the waterfront reconsider a word they used to take for granted, normal.
The new normal. I don't know what the normal might look like.
The home where Kendra Savory grew up is in limbo.
Complete devastation.
The storm surge did not destroy the family home, but it stripped away part of the exterior, filling the basement with mud, leaving her parents with no working sewer pipes.
I'm glad to see that they got the U-Haul and we can get moving, because if someone comes down to inspect the place, they might not be allowed to go back in to get anything.
She says leaving is especially tough on her father.
He got a routine. He goes on the wharf. I can't imagine that he can't come back here and peddle out his chores here. So I hope that he could find comfort somewhere else like he can with his own home.
Since these million-dollar views became a tragic nightmare, most evacuees are staying with friends or family members. As neighbors help each other with everyday chores, the province and the federal government promised displaced residents will be settled by winter, wherever their new normal takes them. Ross Lord, Port-au-Basque, Newfoundland and Labrador.